Bonjour à tous. Je vous souhaite la bienvenue pour ce deuxième petit déjeuner des réalisateurs qui donc se concentre autour du programme numéro 2 de court-métrage en compétition. Je vais donc inviter à me rejoindre sur scène. I would like to welcome Mirai Mitsue. Welcome. And I'd like to thank Nobuo Kidoi for making the translation from Japanese to English. So welcome, Mirai.
Hi.
We'll talk about your film, The Dawn of Apes. And to start, I'd like to talk about the origins of the film. Was it a commission work for Kyoto Lab, or was it a choice of yours to do this film?
まあ、元々は京都、動物園の、まあ、依頼で作ったんですけども、15秒でいいっていうことだったんで、まあ、チンパンジーは15秒しか映像見れない集中力がないからっていうことだったんですけど、まあ、やっぱりちょっとせっかく作るならもっとたくさんの尺を作りたいってことで、半分コミッションで半分自分のオリジナル作品みたいな立ち位置ですね。
Yes, this project started as a commission film from the Kyoto Lab and the Kyoto Animal Zoo. And it's for the experiment for the chimpanzee, how chimpanzee can enjoy the film. So originally, they asked me 15 seconds of the clip, but I wanted to make more, so the result of the film. So maybe this film is a half commission and half my own work.
Okay, and would you tell us what were the results of this experiment? Were the apes' reaction interesting? I mean, compared to humans?
まず、面白かったのが、実験対象になってないチンパンジーが続々と見に集まってきたっていうのが、研究者たちもびっくりした点だったそうです。要するに、強制的に画面の前にいるようにしないと、要するに強制的に見せないと見てもらえないものなんですね、チンパンジーにとって映像が。で、それが自分から、なんだろうって言って興味を持って、檻の中にいるチンパンジーが全員モニターの前に集まったっていうのは、
So what surprised the researcher the most is my work was the most popular film. You know, there are some filmmakers made a film for the project, and most of them are live based on the live action. My work is the only animation film, and chimpanzee really seems like the animation and. The film was shown in a cage, and not all the chimpanzee are, you know, kind of not all the chimpanzee are target, but every chimpanzee in the cage came to the see the film once the was my film was shown. So, yeah.
Wow! Congrats! A new fan base. And yeah, we can see the apes at the end of the film. Was it a choice of yours as well to explain the framework of this commissioned film, or have you been asked by Kyoto Lab to include it at the end?
そうですね。なんか自分、説明するためにまあ入れないと、まあ、ドーンオブエイプってこうタイトルも意味がわからないものになるかなと思ったので、で、その、まあ、やっぱり猿が見るために作ろうと思ったので、こう、まあ、主題っていうものが必要ないと思ったので、人間はこう主題で物を見ますけれども、チンパンジーというのは怒ってる現象を見ていくので、だからとにかく現象をどれだけ自分がこう遊ばせて作るかっていうところで、まあ、最後にそういう、それを見ている視点が欲しかったなっていう。で、図らずも、飼育員とか研究者の人たちが、アニメーションを見ているチンパンジーをまた見てるっていう構図があって、それがなんかちょっと面白い結果になったかなというふうに思います。
So yeah, it was my decision to put the live action part, at the end, because this film is for chimpanzee, and I thought there's no need to think about a subject or a story for this film. The chimpanzee will watch the film as a kind of phenomenon, or natural phenomenon, part of natural phenomenon. So this film is a little bit different from my other films. So I thought it was nice to have a live action part to explain who is audience.
Sure, makes sense. Well, you said that this film is very different from the other one, but I'd like to mention your previous film, Dreamland, Age of Obscure, Poker, Wonder, Jam. It seemed that you are willing to play on colors and shapes again in The Dawn of Apes. What does this film add up to your artistic process?
まずは2014年にアヌシーで上映したワンダーという作品の最後の1分間のパートっていうのがほとんどその前後のフレームも関係なくドローイングを走らせていくっていう作り方をしていて、その作り方でもっとやってみたいで、ワンダーを作っている時もそこのパートをやっている時は自分自身の中で一番こうなんか感情的に盛り上がるものがあったので、そこでもっと作りたいっていうのがあったのと、なるべくそのアニメーションを自分のこう中でもっと自由なものにしていたかったっていうのが、あります。でやっぱり、今その長編のアニメーションを今、西遊記をベースにした作品を作ってるんですけれども、やっぱりその中にこういかに自分の今までやってきたアニメーションをこう展開させるかっていうところの、実験をしていたっていうところもあります。
So in 2014, Wonder, my film, was shown here in the competition. And the last minutes of that film is made by totally improvised. And I didn't make storyboard, and I didn't have any plan. Just watching the paper and draw, and see the paper, draw. I followed the instinct. So that way of making film was really joy for me. So I want to try again for the whole film. So for this film, it's totally improvisation. I didn't have anything in mind before I start animating. Also I try to put some other elements from my previous films. So we will see some connection between my previous film. This is why, because I am developing the feature film project based on the Journey to the West, and it's about a monkey. In this feature film project, I want to combine the character animation with my experimental animation, and maybe from using the motif from my previous films. So maybe this film is a kind of practice for the upcoming project.
Great. We are really looking forward to it. Any questions from the audience? Over there.
Oui, est-ce que vous pouvez en tirer la conclusion que les chimpanzés sont plus attirés par l'animation que par la prise de vue réelle?
の結果でもちょっとちゃんと聞きたくて、その実際にその結果としてアニメーションの方がやっぱりライブアクションよりもチンパンジーにとっては好きなのかっていう、そこら辺のことを何かあったら、
そうですね。その僕アニメーション作ったのは僕だけで、基本的にはその他の人たちは実写をベースにやっていたので、実写ベースになってるということは、なんていうんですかね、そのチンパンジーにとっては見たことがあるものの可能性があって、でそういう意味ではアニメーションで全くこう、ビジュアルとしてというか、こう全く見たことがないものを、作ることが、アニメーションでやる意味があるかなというふうに思いました。で、実験結果としては、まず研究者の方が言っていたのは、全く映像に興味を示さなかった、これまでどんな映像にも興味を示さなかった猿が、 あのものすごい興奮してずっと見続けたので、要するに映像によってはものすごいこう感情が高ぶっていくっていうことが、まあ、分かったっていうのがありますね。
それで その高まるだけのことは主にアニメーションから見せるやつから分かったって感じ、
うんうんうん、あのまあ、そうですね、僕のアニメーションで初めてそういう結果が出たっていうことですね。
So as I told you, this was the only animation film in this project, whole project. And I think if they see the live action film, you know, what they see is, you know, based on the, what they already seen. It's from the real life. So the main difference is for animation is it's totally made up. And for the chimpanzees, this is something they never watched before. So it results, some chimpanzees got really excited, and also I don't know the reason why, but maybe it's because they never seen this.
Yeah, that's an all new experience.
Yeah. So for the researchers, my film was good because they can find it, you know, even the chimpanzee will be excited by the film, and especially when they see the totally new unexpected ones.
Thank you very much, Mira Mitsue et Nobuo Akidoi. J'aimerais inviter maintenant à me rejoindre sur scène Bruno Collet pour le film Mémorable. Tout siège est bon à prendre. Bonjour Bruno. A priori, pas besoin de casque pour l'instant. On va donc parler de Mémorable, qui a été produit chez Vivement Lundi, en France. Donc, Bruno, cette histoire, elle est traitée de façon très douce et intimiste. Et je voulais vous demander à quel point elle était tirée de votre vie personnelle ou de celle de vos proches, ou à quel point elle était fictionnelle.
J'ai eu la chance de ne pas être touché dans mon entourage proche par cette maladie. Mais je me suis bien rendu compte qu'elle était, elle était présente un peu partout, et j'avais envie vraiment de parler de ce sujet. Il y a déjà eu des films d'animation qui ont été faits sur ce thème, et je cherchais une façon de l'aborder un peu différemment. Et c'est en découvrant des tableaux d'un peintre qui s'appelle Hunter Mullen, qui est un peintre anglais, et qui avait un style graphique très, très précis, très détaillé, et il a continué à faire des autoportraits. Donc il dessinait tous les jours son visage, malgré la maladie, et ça jusqu'au moment où il a été hospitalisé. Et j'ai eu la chance de tomber sur l'évolution de ses dessins. Donc pendant 4 ans, il s'est dessiné, et la façon dont il se percevait, avec des couleurs qui devenaient de plus en plus criardes, le trait qui devenait de moins en moins sûr, jusqu'à passer carrément au noir et blanc, et à un moment, il n'arrive même plus à trouver son regard dans ses dessins. Donc on n'a plus qu'un nez, une bouche, et tout ça en noir et blanc, avec un crayonné qui est vraiment déstructuré. Je me suis dit, c'est intéressant de se mettre dans la tête du malade et d'en parler. Comment le malade pourrait appréhender cette perte de mémoire? Mais en même temps, je n'avais pas envie de faire un film... je savais que la fin allait être douloureuse, mais j'avais pas envie de la traiter qu'avec des larmes et apporter de l'humour dans ce projet. Il y avait deux façons. Soit on riait aux dépens du malade qui perd la mémoire, donc on peut trouver des gags là-dessus. Soit je me suis dit non, j'avais pas envie de l'aborder comme ça. Donc il me restait la solution de... C'est le malade lui-même qui a beaucoup d'humour et qui cache cette maladie par des pieds de nez, par des pirouettes. Je pense qu'il a toujours eu de l'humour dans sa vie, mais là il se rend compte qu'il est en train de perdre pied, et il essaye de rester à flot grâce à l'humour, et essayer de persuader son entourage et sa famille que tout va bien. Mais personne ne... Enfin, personne. S'il y a un repas de famille, à un moment, tout le monde est dupé, sauf sa femme qui le vit au quotidien et qui, elle, a bien conscience de l'évolution de la maladie.
Oui, on sent vraiment le comique de situation qui est plus ou moins valable et convaincant pour les proches.
Voilà, dès qu'il y a la possibilité de fuir par l'humour, et, c'est sa bouée de sauvetage.
Donc effectivement, je ne connaissais pas ce peintre, ça remet bien en perspective toute l'histoire. Au-delà de ce peintre-là, j'ai pu noter que vous avez fait quand même des clins d'œil à d'autres plasticiens, d'autres artistes, d'autres grands peintres, Van Gogh, Picasso, Munch. Est-ce que vous voudriez un petit peu plus en parler, sachant que vos précédents films faisaient des clins d'œil, eux, davantage à des figures cinématographiques ?
Ah oui. Ouais, j'avais rendu. Oui, il y avait eu des portraits de Robert Mitchum et un sur Bruce Lee. Effectivement, là je voulais. Moi, je sors des Beaux-Arts, donc je me sentais un peu. Enfin, je me suis un peu identifié à ce malade, mais je voulais pas que ce soit un catalogue non plus d'artistes. Mais c'est que le personnage central du film étant peintre, tout s'efface autour de lui. Et peut-être la seule chose qui lui reste jusqu'à la fin, c'est sa passion pour l'art et pour la peinture. Et voilà, il se raccroche. Et effectivement, les références artistiques deviennent de plus en plus présentes, parce que c'est peut-être les seules qui lui restent, avec le visage de sa femme, qu'il va même oublier à la fin, mais qu'il a envie de peindre. Et à un moment, on a une scène où on voit toute une galerie de peintures qu'il a fait durant sa vie de portraits de sa femme, et on voit l'évolution de son style graphique et l'importance que la peinture a dans sa vie.
Oui, tout à fait, c'est un moment très très touchant. Et donc au sujet des personnages, donc le film est donc fait en stop motion. Il y a une vraie finesse au niveau des personnages, leur expressivité, elle est vraiment remarquable. Moi, ça m'a rappelé Anomalisa de Charlie Kaufman et Duke Johnson. Voilà, est-ce que vous pouvez parler un petit peu de cette direction artistique-là ?
On n'a pas eu le même budget, mais mais on a réussi quand même à s'en sortir. C'est-à-dire qu'on avait un problème technique. Je voulais que le visage du personnage évolue. Donc effectivement, à un moment, il a un visage à la Van Gogh, donc avec plein de petits traits, c'est assez minutieux. Et d'habitude, on travaille l'animation. Je suis un petit peu technique là, mais d'habitude, on travaille avec des masques de substitution et qu'on change à chaque expression du personnage. Mais je ne pouvais pas utiliser cette technique parce que j'avais trop de précision sur chaque masque. C'était impossible de retrouver au même endroit le même coup de pinceau. Donc j'aurais eu des visages qui bougent, qui vibrent énormément. Donc il ne restait que la solution de faire bouger vraiment la tête du personnage avec des têtes en mousse et une armature qui permettait de les faire parler. Et ça a été une bonne chose parce que d'habitude on a une tendance à pousser un peu trop les lips. J'ai vu de certains films où les marionnettes elles parlent, mais alors dans Voilà c'est Gromit, ça a tout à fait son sens et ça donne un vrai caractère au personnage. Mais des fois on est focalisé sur les lèvres. Qu'est-ce qui se passe ? Personne ne parle comme ça en faisant des hauts. Et là, le fait d'avoir utilisé juste un système de clapet, alors ça, on avait préparé, mais on ne savait pas du tout ce que ça allait donner. C'est le premier jour de tournage. On s'est dit, est-ce que ça va marcher ? Et ça marche pas mal. C'est-à-dire qu'on s'habitue très vite à ce système qui est pas loin des Thunderbirds de mon enfance, des marionnettes à fil. Et en fin de compte, on oublie complètement les lips et le regard se porte sur le regard des personnages. C'était vraiment ce que je voulais. Parce que s'il y a une chose qui n'évolue pas pendant tout le film, c'est-à-dire décor, personnage n'arrête pas de changer, mais le regard les yeux de ce couple de personnages va rester pendant tout le film carrément identique, même jusqu'à la fin où sa femme n'est plus que tache de peinture, mais elle a toujours ce même regard. Donc voilà, ce problème, souvent, je ne devrais pas le dire, parce que le producteur est dans la salle, mais le manque de financement nous oblige à être inventifs, et à chaque fois, on trouve des solutions qui sont souvent payantes. Voilà. Mais, bon. Comment ?
Et je précise...
Oui, en fin de compte, il vient de me dire qu'il sert le budget volontairement pour que je sois créatif.
Et je précise notamment qu'on peut retrouver des marionnettes sur le stand de Bretagne au MIFA, pour ceux qui seraient curieux de,
voilà, y a une
vitrine, de voir en direct. Voilà, donc on va passer aux questions du public. Toujours monsieur là-bas.
Oui, moi, votre film m'a fait penser à un film magnifique qui s'appelle Amour de Michael Haneke, que vous avez forcément vu, mmh. où Jean-Louis Trintignant voyait sa femme mourir petit à petit. Et c'est ça qui m'amène à vous dire que vous n'avez pas fait un film sur la maladie d'Alzheimer, vous avez fait un film sur l'amour. Les scènes finales sont bouleversantes. Et je voulais vous demander comment vous aviez travaillé avec les comédiens, deux excellents comédiens qu'on adore tous. Est-ce qu'ils ont enregistré avant le film ou après ? Enfin, éternelle question.
Alors, ils ont enregistré un petit hommage quand même aux comédiens qui incarnent vraiment les personnages, mais qui les ont incarnés un an avant. C'est quand même des acteurs de théâtre et de cinéma qui font rarement de doublage. Donc, le cinéma d'animation, c'était carrément un mystère pour eux. Je crois que quand ils ont enregistré, ils ne savaient pas du tout ce qu'ils faisaient. C'est-à-dire que j'avais emmené des feuilles de storyboard, on avait peut-être l'animatique qui était vraiment, vraiment brute. Et ils pensaient, je crois, qu'ils faisaient une voix pour l'animatique. Enfin, à ce moment-là, ils ont été polis, ils ont dit « Ah, c'est joli les dessins !» Mais c'était abominable. On leur a dit « Non, non, on va faire des marionnettes. » Et ils ont découvert dernièrement le film. Là, ils viennent de découvrir leur voix dans des personnages dont ils ignoraient l'existence et le graphisme. Donc voilà, mais on les a enregistrés. Moi, je voulais qu'ils jouent vraiment à deux. Ils étaient tous les deux et ils se sont joués la scène vraiment tous les deux, mais en se disant qu'est-ce que ça va donner. Enfin, voilà, j'espère que le projet leur plaît, mais c'est vrai qu'ils ont une place assez importante dans l'incarnation des personnages.
Une dernière question ? Oui, jeune homme ? Alors, je vais juste te demander de prendre le micro, s'il te plaît.
En quelle matière sont créées les marionnettes ?
Alors, au début, moi, je les sculpte en pâte à modeler, vraiment, en plastiline. Et après, c'est donné à des techniciens qui les ont moulées, qui vont faire une armature à l'intérieur, et ils vont injecter dans le moule de la mousse de latex. C'est-à-dire comme une mousse de matelas ou comme les guignols de l'info, les marionnettes qu'il y avait sur Canal. Et après, j'ai récupéré les marionnettes pour les peindre. Parce que je voulais, c'est pas le cas dans tous mes courts-métrages ou séries, mais quand je peux mettre les mains dedans, vu que je passe plus de temps maintenant à écrire qu'à dessiner, quand j'ai la possibilité de sculpter ou de peindre, j'aime bien m'y remettre. Mais voilà, et les yeux. Donc tous les corps sont souples et les vêtements sont aussi en mousse de latex. Donc il a fallu sortir plusieurs corps identiques pour le film.
Et du coup, la pâte à modeler, elle était dure ou pas pendant le tournage ? Parce que pour l'animation...
La pâte à modeler, elle sert juste de modèle au départ.
Ah oui.
Et après, on fait un moule. Et dans ce moule, on va couler la mousse de latex qu'on va passer après au four. Et ça nous donne un personnage en mousse. Voilà, elle a pas tant modelé, elle finit recyclée pour refaire d'autres personnages pour un futur projet.
Bon, Bruno, je crois que vous avez trouvé un nouvel assistant. Je vous remercie beaucoup.
Merci à vous.
J'aimerais appeler maintenant à me rejoindre sur scène Christian Holm pour Life 24.
Hello,
welcome. So, Christian, my first question will be, who is Einar Jens Keg, the bachelor who won the lottery?
you just described him.
but he's a kind of a tricky and twisted character in your film, so... What did you try to tell us through his journey in the film, and who is he representing?
Really hard question, but he's I think he's mysterious, like for me also. So I know as much as you.
But where does this guy come from? Who the hell is he?
He's coming out from this trunk of the car, but. but maybe I explain a little bit. Actually, film began with this bomb, or the film idea started with the bomb, and I somehow was you know, the speculation when somebody is dying, then the film is going in front of your eyes about your life. So I was kind of thinking about the end of the bomb, you know, just a few seconds of the before the bomb explodes, the bomb sees, you know, all the childhood of him and everything. And I was writing, I think, the first month, like from the perspective of the bomb, this thing. And one scene was when there was one, you know, drunk person in the car trunk, and then I somehow stuck to this guy, and I started to personalize myself with the other person, and somehow it turned out to be the main character in the end. But who is Einar Jenskeg?
I was mostly wondering.
Old Viking, maybe.
No, but the core of my question was: is he a pure fictional character, or did you read a story in a newspaper somehow
and decided to
just make a film of it?
Yeah, basically completely fictional. But yeah.
Okay, and so this film is built as a loop. The main character that we just talked about appears from a trunk and comes back into it at the end.
Yeah.
What does represent this loop?
Oh, I thought I will make some kind of startup company called Sleep in My Car Wise. It was. I was. You know, why I have to sleep in hotel if I can sleep in car trunk, you know. And today I don't use these smartphone systems by myself, but I think it's quite easy to, you know, book your car trunk through the smartphone and sleep there. And, you know, sleeping in the airport, for instance, you know, if you have some hours for the flight, it's really uncomfortable to sleep in the airport, like waiting rooms, but you know, there is plenty of cars around the airport.
Makes sense. And is there a moral theme that we should keep in mind after watching the film?
Oh, it's too early.
What do you want to teach us?
No moral, I think.
Okay, let's go to the graphic side of the film. Maybe it will be less tricky. I noticed that, like most of your previous films, this film is drawn on paper with white backgrounds, simple and pure. Why choose this aesthetic choice?
Oh, actually, it's first film that I didn't draw on the paper. It's a computer.
Okay, next question. So, please feel free to help me. Anyone, I'll be really happy to give you the microphone. No, seriously.
Maybe I can, I can tell a story by myself, like 10 years ago.
Yeah, sure. Let's talk about you.
I was in Annecy with my student film, and it was late night screening. People are very in the mood already, and my sound, I don't know what the format was, some beta cassette or something, and the sound was a little bit too quiet, and I was in the back row filming my film, and the audience went really mad doing the sounds by the mouth, you know. It was really noisy, like shh, shh, shh. And I was like, yes, 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 you know, the audience makes the film, you know, super, super. And then, you know, the final applause, and I stopped the camera, but the best part was still coming. And one guy stood up and said, oh, you are really unpolite, you know, with these silent films. You should not, like, disturb the film and blah, blah, blah. And I was like, oh, okay. And, well, I didn't get this to the tape to record. I didn't record the final thing. But next morning, I was in the hostel breakfast talking with some local or French students. And when they realized that I'm the director of this film, they said, we thought that you were the person who, that this guy that stood up was the director. So I was like, oh, wow. Yeah. So
okay.
Probably.
Thank you for sharing this very thorough memory. Any question to the from the audience related to the film or to Christian's life?
So, in terms, there's the film is sort of a number of vignettes, right? So, I guess my question is, is there an editing process where you come up with, you know, 30 vignettes and then you pick the right ones, or is it just did you just sort of come up with the vignettes and put them in sequence, you know, and if so, how do you sort of choose the ones that, oh, this will really come alive, you know, in terms of the animation?
I think there were some extra, like, things, but it was quite linear. I was thinking, you know, what's coming up next, and it wasn't, like, a bunch of things I just mixed together. Yeah.
Another question?
Yeah.
Martin?
I was really taken by the anthropomorphic bomb character and deeply touched by the humanity within that character. So he chooses to save the man in the trunk. So I wondered, like, if this character from Beyond the Death is going to write some kind of self-help book, you know, to
Another early morning question.
Now you regret my questions, huh?
Sorry, I give it.
Well, yeah.
No, I'm wondering if, like, you talk a little bit about the psyche of that character. Well, because he seems very, very content to be, or he or she, maybe.
Like I told, content. The POM was the actual main character in the beginning, so.
Yeah.
But I don't know, the POMs are, like, part of the. Part of the modern life, I think, and really demonized. But the bombs are, you know, nobody is thinking about what the bomb actually is, you know. It's just, it might be, like, have their own life and family and stuff, you know, and emotions, so, but they are just used, you know, bad way. I don't know.
Well, thank you for speaking up for that.
I did my best.
Looking sorry, forward so to your
sorry to
next
being
film.
Sleepy. Right.
No, thank you very much. Thanks. Yeah,
thanks.
I'd like now to welcome Skirma Djakaite for the film The Juggler. Welcome. So before asking my first question, I'd like to mention to the audience that your previous film in 2013 was dealing with Euclidean geometry, if I'm not wrong.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I was wondering if you consider that your role as an artist is to share knowledge that you'll get to learn through researches.
I don't know. I think it happens naturally. I don't do that on purpose, I think.
The topic is really precise. That's based on a scientific disease. Or would you explain us more what happened to your characters in the film? Because that's a very specific thing.
Yeah, if you call a life specific thing, then yeah, it's because... that's probably what the film is about the solitary experience of being alive. I started with the thought that it's really fascinating that there are a billion different versions of lives, and I am kind of like doomed to experience only one of them, and I will never ever be someone else, like not in a way that I physically live someone else's life, but that I would feel the world through someone else's eyes. So that was the inspiration for the film.
At the beginning of the film, you are mentioning the concept of emergence.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Would you explain us more what it means, and how did you try to explain it through
No, this emergence is just a phenomenon which I can't explain it. I am not a scientist. So it's just a quote from what it means from scientific part, but what it means from human part. It's like when the phrase ends, as an example, the phenomenon of life, then that's the key, I think, to that.
That's a simple and efficient key. The aesthetic of the characters is not realistic. Why did you decide to picture them in a scary way? And more generally, why is the film so dark?
Because I think that there are parts of being which are really dark, and it draws me to it. I am interested in that, in the dark part, because we kind of avoid that and try to ignore it, but sometimes it's unavoidable. So.
And what about the surrealist design of the characters?
I don't know. That's probably how I see the characters. I can't really explain that.
Would you talk about the sound, which is cyclical and repetitive, and I would say even clinical?
I wanted to. We did the sounds in France with the sound designer David Vincent and French studio. And I wanted to create the sounds which are associated with some certain emotions. So that's why they are repetitive. Like when people are talking, I wanted to create some specific sound design for that apart from words. So yeah, we were looking for that in a very particular way.
And so the dialogues, the original ones, are in French, though you are Lithuanian?
No, I wrote in Lithuania, and then translators, they were translated because I wanted to avoid the necessity to read subtitles as much as possible. Of course, it's not completely possible, but in a way, maybe.
But we still have
that's
English
why
subtitle.
I made. Yeah, but if people, like a lot of the audience knows French, then it's probably it's easier for them to listen. So you don't have to read the subtitles.
So you wrote the story by yourself.
Yeah.
Dialogues
yes.
included.
Yes.
Is that the way you work usually?
The previous film was done together with my colleague, so it was her script and we co-directed it, so it's different ways. Sometimes I work with someone else.
But you haven't worked with a scientific consultant
no.
at some point?
No, because it's not a scientific film and I don't claim any scientific truth or anything. It's not a research.
Don't be sorry. It's not a main goal in life, so that's... thank you. Do you have any question? Yes, Tomek?
How did you came up with idea of like a spider made of spiders? It's like it feels like fractal a little, like the small part contains the big part in itself.
The main idea of all that part was inspired by various, it's usually, you can find it on the internet when people do something unusual and they say that they are doing they paint pictures from dust or like create food from inedible things, and it's like the way to be very exceptional, and nowadays it's difficult to find something which was not done yet, so you have to be very eccentric in that. So I just, and the idea about spiders just came to me spontaneously, that it's like a bit of absurd and also the way to be really unique or seem unique for yourself.
Another question?
Could you talk a little bit about your process and what it sort of entails. Just it's such a visually striking film.
Well, I just I sit and draw it on the computer. Basically, it.
I guess how did your look evolve, or what are some of the inspirations for the look?
Usually, I kind of layer it. I layer, layer, layer until I am satisfied with the result. And sometimes I take away something. Sometimes I add, and until I feel that it's enough.
Thank you, Skirma. Thank you very much. Let's move to Gun Shop with Patrick Smith. Hi, Patrick. Welcome.
Hello.
Hello. So tell us, can we consider your film as a civil act, and how important was it to make a film as an exposure of your country's weapon market?
First off, thank you a lot for this. This is such a great event. I've really never attended anything like it. To be able to sit here and talk to the directors like this, it's really amazing. That said, to answer your question, I think, you know, obviously the film addresses a certain problem in the United States, but a worldwide problem, actually, but maybe specifically in the United States. And this is my first stop motion film, for lack of a better term, object pixelation, perhaps. And I was, since my background is hand drawn, I was looking for a powerful object to represent something emotional, perhaps a political problem, but that wasn't necessary. And I've always been fascinated with guns. I think they're beautiful, but in a very strange way. They're beautiful and they're horrifying at the same time. So I don't think there's an object quite like guns. They really stand alone, and that was the main thrust of the film.
Would you tell us more about your creative and production process? Did you borrow guns from stores and museums? Did you buy them, rent them? Was it easy to get them? And what were the stores, owners, and museums' reactions?
Most of the photos were taken illegally. I would sneak into a gun shop and...
Okay, stop
and
YouTube.
Sue me, I didn't make any money, so... and I have none. Most people were very very helpful. Even knowing the politics behind the film, most shops in the United States they were excited about the project and they wanted to see it when I was done, and that was actually very shocking to me. I learned a lot about the people in this culture within the United States, and that actually affected my politics a little. So my politics changed from when I started and when I ended, and that was, I think, personally the most shocking part of making the film. To your question, I like I said, I went to gun shops and museums, and I took them, some of them just even with my phone, but I ended with maybe only a few hundred photos, and they were the guns that were the easiest accessible guns, handguns mostly, so, and that was a problem. So I started writing letters to gun manufacturers, and they actually, several gun manufacturers provided me with high resolution images of their guns. Also, another gun distributor in the Midwest sent me a lot of photos of their guns. I still didn't have enough because I needed over 2,000 for this film, because the music was done first. So I knew the length of the film. So the last thing that worked really well is on Facebook and social media, all the social media and also message boards. I appealed to everyone. I was like, hello, please take a photograph of your gun and send it to me. I'm doing this project. And that, I got an overwhelming amount of guns. Yeah, most of them, the photos weren't usable. They weren't good quality. But some of them, there was one person in particular, which is very frightening. He sent me over 200 photos of his... He had them, and they weren't normal guns either. They were really high-powered rifles and military style, which scared me. But I, you know, thought about the film, didn't get scared about that. And I also made sure he didn't know my contact information. So.
Yeah, you'd better keep them secret. And about the audience's reaction, was it different in the US than abroad?
Well, it's difficult because, you know, film festivals are such a diverse crowd. I mean, there's plenty of Americans here, and so I don't know. All I know is that it seems split down the middle, and it doesn't seem associated with the country or anything. I kind of knew this when I was going in. This is an emotional subject. I'm fascinated by guns. Other people are repulsed by them. So, and I knew that. So some of the reaction, specifically at the premiere in Stuttgart, were very hard. And it forced me to really think about the reasons I made the film and to better articulate those reasons, which I think that was good. But no, some people were not happy about this film. There was actually several people who suggested perhaps it was a pro-gun film, which I don't agree with. I think there's an obvious juxtaposition that is critical of the culture. I think this the few people that have said that, I think they were responding to the fact that I kind of lifted my own opinion out of it, and I let the guns speak for themselves, which I think is a better way to make a film. Nobody cares about my opinion, you know.
You mentioned in the ending credits your gratitude to George Griffin and Paul Bush. Mm. How much have they influenced or helped you for the film?
So much. I can't even say. So, like I said, I've only done hand-drawn films, and I know nothing about stop motion, and I was always very intimidated. But a decade ago or so, I was here in Annecy, and I saw the retrospective, Paul Bush's retrospective. And even back then, I was like, that is a really amazing technique. And I've always thought about it, and I played with it. And when I taught at New York University, we did exercises in class with that technique. And I think just recently, a colleague of mine gave me a very harsh critique about my hand-drawn films. And he said that I've been making the same film for 20 years. And I think he was right. So at the time, my wife told me, she's like, well, maybe you should do this film you have in your head, the stop motion one. So that's why I went there. I had Paul Bush in my head when I made the film, as well as earlier pieces by Svenk Meyer and others. I think it would be very difficult to find 10 films in this style. It has a long tradition, but it's a very small tradition. I think that was another reason why I made the film. I thought it was a very unexplored medium, a technique rather.
Any questions from the audience? Tomek again, and then Nancy.
You mentioned that your view towards the guns and gun culture like changed while you were making the movie. So what was the beginning and the end, and what was this change?
In the beginning, I had a certain image of a person who owned a gun. I had a stereotype in my head, and it wasn't anything I approved of. I still don't. But what happened while making the films and having interaction with these people that are, well, in the US we call them gun nuts, you know, like crazy gun people. During that interaction, I realized how these are thinking people. They're not just crazy gun people. They have their own politics that, of course, are different than mine, but they're very cooperative and very open-minded, and that shocked me. I didn't think a gun owner would be an open-minded person. I just, my own judgment, and that. So it kind of taught me to maybe open my own mind, and to be accepting to other people's politics, particularly in things that you're very passionate about. It's difficult, but it was, yeah.
Nancy,
I think one of the things that really amazed me in your film, and I hadn't really thought about it much, were the number of guns who looked like ladies' guns. And I'm curious about what percentage of the female population responded to you with their guns, and why. Did you ever ask any of these women why you're carrying this pink thing that looks kind of like a poodle that can kill somebody?
Well, you know, it's a really interesting segment of gun sales or the gun market. It's a very interesting segment. There is a large demographic in the United States. I can't speak for other countries. I only know the United States. But there's a large demographic of women. And this demographic is very interested in feminized guns, pink guns. We shot one gun with a Hello Kitty image on it. Yeah, and there's also, by the way, there's also, this is really twisted. It wasn't just that one gun. Some of them were, I would say, almost practically marketed toward children. But more accurately marketed toward families that want to go shooting together and that type of thing. Yeah, it's very scary, but it's there, you know. And as far as your specific question about the percentage of the market that is female, larger than you would think. The people I interacted with, I would say, were probably 20% female. As far as the market itself, the objects, I would say a small percentage were manufactured in pink and other feminine colors, yeah.
So I could get a lavender designer gun in my evening hour?
Yes, you could. Well, you know, there's another interesting thing. There's a lot of custom guns. A lot of people purchase a gun in a specific color, and then they decorate them themselves. And we shot a few of those, yeah.
Thank you very much, Patrick.
Yes, you're welcome.
I'd like to invite on stage Tomek Popakul for Acid Rain. Hi, Tomek. Welcome. So your film is dealing with the coming of age and being or feeling on the edge of the society. What inspired you to create this story and the main character?
I think I'm still interested in this like so-called teenage movies. Next, my movie will be also a teenage movie, and I don't know why. I think I somehow missed it in my teenage years in my life. And for example, I started to go to the parties very late, like when I was, I hope, a little bit wiser about many things. And the idea was, my two previous films was black and white and very dark, and I wanted to make something colorful and something that I like techno parties and electronic music, so I wanted to make a movie about that. And inspiration for the character, I had a lot of problem with that thought, with do I have right or do I have any experience to depict a female character. But after all, I think it's actually just these two characters are like two sides of me, like this light and naive part and this like some kind of dark part. And I, like, many times I'm very naive and I trust people much and I'm fascinated by them, so I'm kind of, I have blind trust, and many times I'm surprised. So I think this like naivety I wanted to depict in this main character.
I understood that this film is about the Polish term douchologia, close to the English ontology. Would you explain us this concept?
Yeah, I don't know how it's like, how it's popular in other countries. This the only term I found in English speaking culture. It's ontology, which is kind of feeling towards, or more like imagery towards some images or sounds from the past that were like before you were born or before you were conscious. So you, for example, you didn't grow up in the 90s or you didn't grow up in the, I know, communist Poland, but these objects and this imagery like are popping off in many parts of your reality, and they are like somehow like ghosts from the past. And I feel this like 90s feeling and this like edge of this fall of communism and the like early stages of capitalism that I barely remember as a child. This is kind of very specific atmosphere that I can say it's my experience. It's kind of part of visual culture to stylize your image into something retro and something like it's something that it's creepy because it's from the past. It's so you go to the attic or you open your grandparents' drawer and you find some old stuff like from the past, and it's kind of creepy only because it's from the past. And there is nothing scary about it, but there is something weird in that. Yeah.
Thanks. Any questions from the audience? Yes, over there.
Hello. It was very impressive film, and I was very moved. And especially that there are many reasons, but one of the particular reasons that I was moved was that movement of the character. Is it you made it, or it was computer related? Because it's very strange movement, and it fit very well to the character. I thought very good.
So it's very compound topic in my movie, but mainly I would say the source of the movement is motion capture, which I'm big fan of motion capture. But sometimes, so this movie is kind of depiction how motion capture can go wrong, and like it was like so we finally we tested like two motion capture systems, and I don't want to make any black marketing, but my personal advice, like, don't use this like Kickstarter home use motion capture. It's not yet. I hope this technology will be available in a few years, but now it generates a lot of bugs, which you've seen in the movie, and it is a lot of cleaning. And we did, like, finally, we just, my advice is just pay a lot of money, go to professional studio and record it. That's what I would do if I would move back in time. But we were like really enthusiastic about this home use one, but it generates very like weird errors, and sometimes I don't know, you feel like that when you take something and you feel like you have additional limbs, or so sometimes I thought, oh, it fits, and like so basically it's going through the difficult process of motion capture things. Yeah.
Thanks. Martin, one last question.
Hi. The principal character begins engaging in risky behavior right in the very first scene. And we see this gradual escalation of things becoming more dangerous, and the behaviors becoming of her companion becoming more erratic and dangerous. So this builds toward what we think is going to be a really climactic moment, and yet then she just pretty much walks away from the climax, and then very shortly thereafter begins another hitchhiking adventure on the road. Were you worried that this would flatten the story arc? And or be misinterpreted as just endorsement of this risk-taking behavior?
Hard to say, because I'm the author, so I think I should ask the audience how they feel about it. Like, my intention was that this like screaming part is really the climax, and I feel it's the climax, and later parts, this like slow like calming down and decline is just kind of like dealing with your trauma, and you just need time, and you need to digest your feelings that you actually don't know what happened in yourself, and you are too surprised to react to that quick. I think that was my tension, and yeah, I wanted this like slow, very calm ending. That was intentional. I don't know if I answered the question.
I guess so.
Does this mean that did you want to have any backstory presented for the character? Because you know we see her in the very first scene as the backpack and hitchhiking, and even later when she goes back on the road, you have only that one scene in there. Where you did you want to depict some kind of reason for why she was on the road?
Of course, I wanted open ending, but my wish for her, or my intention is just she's not stopped by this bad experience. For example, I was like from many people who are hitchhiking, they have some traumatic, dangerous experiences, and it could scare them off from continuing that. But she's just a feature of that experience, and she's back in the. I think she's such person that is constantly like searching for something in her life, so she's never stopped by anything. So she's continuously on the road. I think.
Yeah, we feel it clearly at the end. Thank you very much, Tomek.
Thank you.
And now I'd like to invite on stage Chen Qi for the film The Six. From China. Welcome.
Hello, thank you.
So let's start from the title. What symbolizes the number six, and is it related to the overall meaning of the film?
Yes, because the film, there's only one scene. And it repeat six times, and also it's a constant of in traditional religion, Buddha religion, it's a six loop. I don't know. Sorry, I don't know how to say the person birth and death and become animal.
Six stages.
Yeah. And is the meaning come from that one? So I think it's a little bit interesting. And also my film is based on Asian shogun. It's a traditional and erotic painting of China, and I think the six sound like a little bit like sex, so so I think the title is interesting.
Thanks for this explanation. So you mentioned this illustration, erotic illustration. Are you also influenced by the traditional shadow theater?
Yes, in ancient Asia painting, we have a lot of kind of painting. Yes, I influenced by wood print painting, also the shadow play painting. Yes, I influence a lot from that.
I would say that even more than in your previous films, you played a lot with lighting, staging, and perspective in this film. Is it a way for you to lead the viewer's attention?
You mean, sorry.
Sorry. So in your previous film, you already worked a lot on black and white, on light, on staging, perspectives, and it's even more remarkable in this film. Is it for you a way to lead the spectator sight on some parts of the film?
Yeah, yes. I focused on it, and I'm very curious if I could find some way to create some language for animation language to express Asian painting, Asian old painting. So I don't like use the montage and also the zoom in and the zoom out. So I think maybe it will the animation is it's quite important. How to move is quite important for the style of the painting. And if the two things cannot connect, so I don't think this will. So I try to find something new or some new language or some new way to use move and also which one is fit for the painting style. Do you understand? Sorry, my English.
All clear. And that's actually the last film that you co-directed with Xu Han as a co-director. Mm-hmm. How do you develop it together? How have you worked together?
Yes, I remember last year I was here and Master Zhang posed the question the same. And you know, my co-director died 2 years ago. And before when he laid on the dead, we talk a lot about our new question, our new project, and also each week we telephoned, and even in the last month of his life, and so after 2017, I continue to complete our project, the previous one and this one. Yeah, maybe the next one.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Any questions from the audience? Okay, Martin.
Hi, really like the film. Did you have a specific character that you wanted us to empathize with? I mean, I know say it's a feature film, but something like Zhang Yimou's Raise the Red Lantern, you know, would have sort of a similar sequence of a man with a number of different wives. Was there a particular character that you wanted us to build empathy for?
I don't understand exactly.
Who did you want us to identify with in the film? The man wandering through the different episodes or any of the women in the scenes?
For my habit, I always paint something and imagine maybe a lot of details appeared, so I continue to make it animation. But it's just my way to create a new film. So I have no too much idea, and when I paint something, some idea appear, and I could something clear more and more, so I could finish the design and the animation.
So at first they were. No main character that you would like us to focus on.
No, I have a very not very clear. The idea isn't very wasn't very clear, but more and more it should be clear.
Yeah, it has become clearer and clearer the way you were
exactly
working.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And so the last interview will be Dahe Jung. For Movements, bienvenue.
Bonjour.
Bonjour.
Donc, Dahe, ce court-métrage a bénéficié de deux résidences pour sa production, Fontevraud en France et la Cinémathèque québécoise. Est-ce que vous pouvez en parler? Qu'est-ce que ça a pu apporter au film? Et est-ce que vous pensez que vous auriez fait un autre film dans un cadre différent, dans une maison de production purement?
D'autres productions, c'est-à-dire dans d'autres résidences ou...
Non, justement, pas via des résidences, mais au sein d'une maison de production avec un producteur attitré, sans avoir tous ces inputs des différents superviseurs et consultants dans les résidences.
Oui, tout d'abord, pour expliquer sur les résidences, ça m'a beaucoup aidé pour développer les histoires. et surtout à la résidence de la Cinémathèque québécoise, j'avais un manteau qui discute sur mon scénario. Ça m'a beaucoup aidé. Oui, c'était une belle expérience. Oui, j'aimerais bien explorer, travailler avec d'autres productions en France ou au Canada. Oui.
Et à Fontevraud, est-ce que dans cette résidence, vous avez travaillé seul? Est-ce que vous étiez aussi entouré de consultants qui vous ont aidé à développer le film, soit au niveau de l'écriture, soit au niveau vraiment des premières recherches graphiques?
Et je travaillais seule, mais il y avait des autres résidents, 10 résidents, alors on a beaucoup discuté entre nous. Et aussi au début de la résidence, il y avait l'atelier de Mikhaël de Dr. Witt. Oui, on pouvait discuter avec lui aussi. Oui.
Vous avez été très chanceuse. Et donc, pour poursuivre sur ma question du développement, d'un point de vue technique, vous avez donc, on peut distinguer dans le film de la 2D, de la 3D, de la mocap, de la motion capture. Est-ce que vous pouvez expliquer ce choix de mélange de techniques qui, au final, ont donné un rendu homogène au film ?
Homogène, c'est quoi ?
Juste unique.
Mais je décide les techniques après. J'écris d'abord le scénario et je cherche comment je peux exprimer ce scénario. Comme ça, mais en général, je dessine à la main, en 2D, mais j'utilise les 3D pour exprimer l'espace, tourner la chambre. Oui, c'est ça.
Et au sujet de la motion capture, est-ce que c'est la...
Non, je n'ai pas utilisé motion capture.
D'accord. Parce que dans le générique de fin, c'est noté qu'il y a de la motion capture.
Non, non. En fait, c'était... Comment dire j'ai tourné. Ah oui, tu as tourné les mouvements parce que tu voulais les mouvements assez réalistes. Alors, après, en regardant cette vidéo, j'ai fait l'animation. Ce n'était pas motion capture.
D'accord, c'est plus clair, merci beaucoup. Et donc, au niveau de la thématique du film, donc vous parlez du temps qui passe. C'est un sujet qui pourrait être traité avec mélancolie, mais ce film est vraiment très joyeux, il est léger, il est frais. Est-ce que vous pouvez nous parler de ce choix vous avez finalement fait un contre-pied au niveau du ton?
Et quand j'ai commencé à écrire ce film, l'un de mes amis m'a dit que je suis trop rapide par rapport à lui, mais l'une de mes amies me disait que j'étais lente. Alors j'ai réfléchi à la vitesse de chacun et à la relativité. Comme ça, j'ai traité ce sujet un peu joyeux et en parlant de la diversité des gens. Et aussi, quand j'étais à l'école, j'avais écrit en mémoire sur l'immobilité et la mobilité. Et j'avais recherché des différentes vitesses du mouvement. Alors, je les ai représentées en personnages. Oui, c'est ça. J'ai créé des personnages hyper lents, lents, moyens, rapides et à l'envers.
Dans la scène où les personnages peignent un mur, on voit un petit clin d'œil, je pense à ce qu'on peut appeler la société de l'immédiateté qui existe aujourd'hui, à travers la barre de progression YouTube. Est-ce que c'était aussi une volonté de votre part de questionner en fait, justement, le temps qui passe aujourd'hui dans notre société où tout va très vite?
Oui, exactement. Et aussi... Je pense que dans mes films, je présente mes réflexions sur qu'est-ce que l'image ou sur qu'est-ce que l'image en mouvement. Et dans ces films, j'ai utilisé beaucoup de supports audiovisuels comme YouTube, la télévision, le cinéma, le portable. Et parce qu'on voit beaucoup d'images par ces supports. Et bon, pendant que le spectateur regarde ce film, il voit ça, ces supports. J'aimerais qui prennent conscience qu'il est en train de regarder un film peut garder la distance avec des images.
Merci beaucoup. Est-ce que vous avez des questions? Pas de questions. Eh bien, écoutez, merci beaucoup.
Merci.
Je vous souhaite une bonne journée à tous. Et puis, je vous rappelle que la prochaine séance de court-métrage en compétition sera aujourd'hui à 14h en grande salle. Et je vous donne donc rendez-vous avec Marcel Jean demain matin pour les interviews des réalisateurs.
Festival international du film d'animation d'Annecy.
Ooh!